Hello again, House of Destiny. Today I'm going to speak to you just for a couple of minutes about combating fear. Don't know about you, but as in an individual capacity, fear is something I've kind of always struggled with. I know that it may not appear that way off the bat, but you know, anxiety, apprehension, fear, these are things I've had to combat in my life. And so it's something that I've kind of been facing, and I was like, you know what? I'm pretty sure there's a bunch of us that have been facing a similar thing. There's so much uncertainty right now. There's so many things that are unknown. There's so many things that don't seem like they necessarily have an end. But in those situations, that's when it counts the most for us to be able to place our feet firmly on the solid rock who is Christ Jesus. And so let's look at this for a second. Fear means to expect or worry about something bad or unpleasant. And anxiety means painful or apprehensive uneasiness of mind, usually over an impending or anticipated ill. It's an abnormal and overwhelming sense of apprehension and fear, often marked by physiological signs such as sweating, tension, increased pulse, by doubt concerning the reality and nature of the threat, and by self-doubt about one's capacity to cope with it. And every single one of us on this planet, we're going to be afflicted by fear or anxiety at some point, some more than others. But I think a key is for us to be able to identify what it is that makes us feel anxious. On a superficial level, my two probably biggest fears, well, three, the biggest ones, are spiders, heights, and small spaces. Those are three kind of surface level fears that I have, that they're things that I have to combat constantly. You know, even cable cars, going up the mountain to Masada in Israel, I had a little bit of a freak out because I was like, I'm in a box dangling in the air, suspended by a piece of wire in the desert. What am I doing with my life? You know, have these moments, whereas other people love it. So every single one of us, and I'm talking about a superficial fear here, but if I had to be honest about, like, probably since I was a child, the biggest sort of existential fear I've always had has been, what if I don't fulfill the will of God for my life? What if I fail to attain what it is that God has for me? That's probably one of the bigger existential fears. But in a personal capacity, like I said, fear is something I do struggle with. Anxiety is something I do struggle with. I'm just being transparent and open with you. But this is the thing. There are roots to the fruits of our lives. Matthew chapter 7, verses 16 to 19 says this, "But you will recognize them by their fruits. You don't find sweet, delicious grapes growing on thorny bushes, do you? You don't find delectable figs growing in the midst of prickly thistles." This is the Message version, if you were wondering why it sounds a little different. "People and their lives are like trees. Good trees bear beautiful, tasty fruit, but bad trees bear ugly, bitter fruit. A good tree cannot bear ugly, bitter fruit, nor can a bad tree bear fruit that is beautiful and tasty. And what happens to the rotten trees? They are cut down. They are used for firewood." There are roots to every single thing that we struggle with in our lives. And we can run around trying to cut down, get rid of the fruit of an issue. But until we deal with the source or the root or where it's coming from, we're going to continue to grow and sprout the exact same fruit. And I'm speaking this to myself probably more than I am to anybody else, because so often I think we can run around being completely distracted or bogged down by the results of all these things, like constant anxiety about the same thing. Well, that is probably the product of one root that is producing a variety of fruits that have the same link. So if there's constant sources of anxiety or fear or frustration, there's generally a root cause to those things. And that's what I think a key for us to do is to identify that for ourselves, because the issues that I have are going to be completely different to the issues that you have. But the one thing is for certain, we all have our issues. We're all rowing in some form of issue boat. But the beautiful thing is that Jesus is here to set us free. And you know, fear begins at an early age. Children are afraid of the dark. They're afraid of monsters. They're afraid of being left alone. And obviously when there's some form of abuse or neglect, those fears are much deeper. There's a much deeper root to, you know, existential fear or ontological fear that comes from abuse or neglect. And that's a whole other series of things that, you know, I think people have to deal with. And that's why it's so important for us to be forms of support for one another, and why community is so important, because sometimes it's just almost impossible to have to fight through everything on our own. And God created us to be in community for a reason. But you know, this is an interesting thing. For a lot of us, we won't say that we're afraid because society has taught us that fear is weakness. I'm going to say that again. Society has taught us that fear is weakness, but we will say that we're anxious because society has taught us that anxiety is a form of responsibility. But at the end of the day, fear, anxiety, they have the same root. And at the end of the day, it's in direct contradiction to what it is that Jesus exhorts us to do. Matthew chapter 6, verses 25 to 34 says this: "That is why I tell you not to worry about everyday life, whether you have enough food and drink or enough clothes to wear. Isn't life more than food and your body more than clothing? Look at the birds. They don't plant or harvest or store food in barns, for your heavenly Father feeds them. And aren't you more valuable to him than they are? Can all your worries add a single moment to your life? And why worry about your clothing? Look at the lilies of the field and how they grow. They don't work or make their clothing. Yet Solomon in all his glory was not dressed as beautifully as they are. And if God cares so wonderfully for wildflowers that are here today and thrown into the fire tomorrow, he will certainly care for you. Why do you have so little faith? So don't worry about these things, saying, 'What will we eat? What will we drink? What will we wear?' These things dominate the thoughts of unbelievers, but your heavenly Father already knows your needs. Seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and he will give you everything you need. So don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring its own worries. Today's trouble is enough for today." Now again, this scripture is one that I've read often, I've spoken from often, but when you actually sit down and think it through and boil it down, some of what is being said here or commanded or exhorted, it sounds really simple, but it can be really difficult. I have one of those brains that sometimes feels like a train station, and sometimes it's like a Swiss train station, and sometimes it's like a South African train station, and sometimes they collide and sometimes they're fine, and it can just feel a little bit chaotic and frenzied in there. Generally, all of them are swirling around with one series of anxieties. It's excellent. Great, great brain train station. And for some of you, you might not relate to that, but for some of you, you might. Sometimes it's so difficult to just lie down and go to sleep because there's so much concern, and a lot of that is valid concern. But what we're being told here is that in essence, anxiety and fear are the opposite of faith. And that's not being said with any condemnation or judgment. That's being said with compassion, that we have to understand that one of the combatants of fear and anxiety is faith. And, you know, we know that without faith, it's impossible to please God. We know that faith is being certain of what we hope for, convinced of what we do not see. But the questions that I would have to ask would be, what is it that makes you anxious or fearful or worried? And what then I would ask, what do you think the result is of those things? I know what the result is in my life. But in order for us to get free of something, we have to first identify it. And one of the combatants of fear and anxiety, one is faith and the other is love. 1 John 4:18 says, "Love will never invoke fear. Perfect love expels fear, particularly the fear of punishment. The one who fears punishment has not been completed through love." And 2 Timothy 1:7, most of us know this: "For God has not given us a spirit of fear and timidity, but of power and love and self-discipline." And the scripture in 1 John 4:18 is a difficult one for me, to be honest, because I know that I'm so punishment aware. I'm so aware of consequence. I'm so aware of, you know, when you kind of grow up and I suppose post-modern day Protestantism / Pentecostalism, there's so much awareness of hell. There's so much awareness of consequence. There's so much awareness of what happens if you don't do the right thing. And obviously there has to be a balance there somewhere. But I know, and it's something that I've been journeying lately, is this awareness that I'm so punishment oriented that so often I think I've done the right thing because I've been afraid of the consequence of doing the wrong thing, when in reality, the motivation that I think pleases God truly is when I do the right thing because I love him, not because I'm afraid of what he'll do to me if I don't do the right thing. And that's a journey I'm currently on. I'm not going to pretend that I'm there. I'm not, but it's a journey. Obviously, it's not God's will for us to be afraid. He wants us to walk in complete peace and victory. And to overcome this fear and anxiety, the predominant battlefield is in our mind. The war is in our mind. And the love of God is what truly does make us free. You know, we need to cultivate this atmosphere that brings a starving of worry and a feeding of love. And whether you do that through scripture, through watching things, through listening to music, whatever it is, my encouragement to you is to be aware, firstly, to identify what your fears and anxieties are. Secondly, firstly, there's an identification. Secondly, to be prepared to own it and say, okay, this is what it is. I see this. I take responsibility to this extent. Also being aware of, you know, sometimes for us, things that happen to us as children are totally out of our control. And we have to be okay with the fact that some of the things that happened may have been our fault, but some may not have been our fault. But the key in all of this is to know God is not angry and that His love is the antidote to fear. We identify the things that are making us afraid, we take responsibility, and then we realize that love is the antidote to fear. So wherever it is that you're at in life, whatever it is that you're facing, I pray that you would this week be able to combat fear through faith and love by identifying things, by asking God to show you the root of what it is that is in your life and my life that could have produced these series of fears, worries, anxieties, whatever it is, and then to be aware above all that love is the thing that is going to bring the antidote to deep-rooted fear. And I pray that you would be blessed as you go out this week. I pray that this word would have brought light and life to you. And I pray that the seed of the word that's been planted in you over the years, that this would have just been a little bit of watering of that seed and that you would see the fruit of it in your life. God bless you. Hope you have a beautiful week.
Thank you for joining us today. We're so glad that you did. We want you to know that we here at the House of Destiny care about your needs, whether it's physical, financial, or spiritual. It's important to us. You can email us at hope@houseofdestiny.org, and we would love to pray for you. You are special to God, and you are special to us.